be bursting with fighters, men, and support equipment. Sunday, October 21st, the skies over Florida and the Gulf of Mexico were under constant surveillance of ADC radar, airborne radars aboard patrolling RC-121s, and high-performance Air Force space track facilities of the NORAD Space Detection and Tracking System, which had been reoriented to the south to provide a few precious minutes' warning should a Cuban-launched missile attack come. The 330...
At the end of World War II, captured V-2 missiles and components were brought to the United States. Good use was made of them at White Sands Proving Grounds in New Mexico. Reassembled and modified V-2s were tremendously valuable teaching tools in what was soon to become a vigorous American effort to enter the rocket missile age.
3, 2, 1, 0.
In World War II, we had already used several types of small rocket-driven weapons. And in Korea, the Air Force again used such weapons launched from aircraft against targets either on the ground or in the air. And before long, we had others, including the Falcon, a fast, accurate, and powerful guided missile launched from our interceptor aircraft. The Genie, an unguided weapon, is the first air-to-air missile that carries a nuclear warhead. It, too, is launched from Air Force fighter aircraft. The Matador was the Air Force's first successful ground-to-ground guided missile. It is boosted off by a rocket, and then a turbojet engine takes over. Electronically controlled by ground personnel, the Matador is a reliable tactical missile that can be armed with a nuclear warhead. The Mace is an improved version of the Matador, larger, faster, and of greater range. Our first answer to the need for a long-range strategic missile was the Snark. Again, a jet pilotless aircraft started on its flight by rocket boosters. The Snark was the world's first intercontinental missile. It had a range of about 5,000 miles. Pilotless interceptor, the Air Force Bomark, a guided missile launched from the ground and capable of destroying approaching hostile bombers hundreds of miles from our shores at very high altitudes. It gained much importance in plans for the defense of our borders. After the launching by a rocket, it is powered at supersonic speed by twin ramjet engines. Through the period of missile development in the 1950s, the concept of the mixed force was evolving. That is, we of course needed and for years would continue to need manned aircraft. Vastly improved bombers capable of delivering nuclear weapons became ready for use. The B-47 as a highly dependable modern medium bomber and the B-52 as a fine long-range bomber, like the B-47, a source of the Strategic Air Command's great deterrent strength. For a considerable period, each of the two systems, manned aircraft and ballistic missiles, would have its own marked advantages. But while the successful use of bombers depends to some extent on tactics and countermeasures, a ballistic missile, with its hypersonic speed, can reach its target with small risk of interception by enemy aircraft. It was a most promising partner to the long-range bomber. So, in the 1950s, we embarked on one of the greatest crash programs in our history for the development of intermediate range and intercontinental ballistic missiles. With the Thor, the Air Force had its first intermediate range missile. It began a series of successful launchings in 1957 and was destined to win a place for itself in the arsenal of the free world. Besides being a good military missile, the Thor has been used with great success as a booster for satellites and space probes. The Air Force is rightly proud of the Thor. Test missiles were of immense value in the accelerated program for the development of an intercontinental missile. The X-10, though driven by turbojet engines, taught us much about aerodynamic design for missiles with supersonic speed and about automatic guidance. And the X-17, a three-stage test missile, revealed much needed information on nose cone design. It saved a lot of time and money in solving problems of re-entry at high speed and consequent high temperatures. In 1955, the highest national priority was given, by order of the President, to the development of the Atlas. Late in 1957, the Air Force achieved the first successful launching of this giant. Some months later, when the Atlas was fully tested, our country took on new confidence in its missile capability. The Atlas became a vital part of our military strength. And other formidable missiles, such as Titan and Minuteman, were in the research and testing stage. In the short span of 40 years, we had progressed from the bug, small, slow, feeble, uncertain, and certainly primitive, to powerful, long-range, supersonic rocket-powered missiles, a tremendous technical achievement by many thousands of people in and out of uniform who labored in the interests of the United States Air Force.